Denise, you are, and welcome back to your celestial one-stop pod for all things rugby sevens. That's right, you're back in seventh heaven. We brought you the men's Olympic preview last night, but it is time for the women's. Last night, we were joined by Rory McConachie and the walking sevens Wikipedia, Rob Vickerman. He's back again for a bit more action, but I've upgraded for the women's edition. We've got the sorcerer of the microphone of Southern Hemisphere sevens. We got Rikki, Swannell up in the clouds. It's great to have you both. Let's talk some sevens.
Well, where do I go from an intro like that? Far out. We've had a high note early.
Well done, mate. You nailed that.
It's all downhill from here. Downhill from here, guys. Oh, there you go. I'm already stumbling. How are you guys? How's times in Tokyo?
Come on, Rikki. You're the special guest. You answer.
Oh, thank you. It's certainly interesting. I'm not confined to my room as some, so there's small mercies. I'm a 10-minute walk from the broadcast centre, the IBC, so I'm allowed to walk. Got a great local convenience store, which stocks a fine array of all sorts. Uber Eats, I think I've got sorted now, and I'm ready to crack into some sport, really.
This could quickly turn into some sort of Sauvignon session, actually, couldn't it, with just Rikki giving us the lowdown of the best ones to drink.
I've got the Asahi Gold on the go right here.
A Chilean drop of Sav in the local, which they restocked today. Having been here a week already, I think I'm the only one buying it. So I'm quite pleased with the restock.
You collect empty bottles, don't you? Which just sounds so much better than alcoholic.
You're casting aspersions on me already, Vickerman. This is going to go well. This could be a long podcast.
Well, to be honest, I gave Byrnesy a fair bit yesterday, and I realised that he hasn't left his room since, so he's probably reflecting quite a lot on it. So I thought we'd just move on to a bit of Kiwi bants.
Yeah, so I see the low blows are coming in nice and early, so it bodes well for the pod. Look, if Seventh Heaven is guilty of one thing, it is probably being too Great Britain and England centric. So just to give some background to our listeners, the Rikki works for Sky Sports NZ. She's one of the voices on the World Series Sevens. She's out here covering all manner of sports for the Olympics. So she is one of the most in-the-know people when it comes to sevens, men's and women's. But we're focusing on the women's, and she's going to be trying her best to not be a traditional biased, smug Kiwi about her nation's prospects coming into this tournament, even though we all know what the Black Ferns are about. And we're looking forward to extracting a bit of knowledge from you, Rikki. What's the feeling from New Zealand, men's and women, coming into this Olympics?
Men and women. Look, the New Zealand men came in to do their media with their media conference today. They came into the main press centre, so mainly obviously Kiwi media, a few internationals as well. First thing was that Tim Mickelson came an absolute gutser as he walked into the press conference. So if you get a chance to have a look around Instagram, you can find it on the All Black Sevens, or it'll start to do the rounds of the actual.
It's on yours as well.
All mine. And it was so funny. The poor guy, he just went down, only 6 foot plus. And we all kind of went, oh, and then hoped he was okay, and then got up, and he very good naturedly took all the grief that and Clark Laidlaw in particular gave him. But they were pretty relaxed, the guys, the men's team. They were in Townsville. They had a bit of a lockdown in Townsville for a couple of days. Of course, then they lost Sam Dixon, who did a hamstring like on the last training session before they came over, and apparently it was like it wasn't a really bad injury, but it was bad enough that he wouldn't have got through this tournament. So he was replaced by Amanaki Nicole, who's his flatmate. They live together, but from what I gather too, it was really emotional, the selection of the New Zealand men in particular, like good emotional, but quite emotional among the Kiwi guys. So that was big. Yeah, so the guys are good. The women have just got here. They stayed in Townsville longer. So they've actually only just arrived. They got delayed getting out of Townsville. Then they got delayed in Brisbane. They had to get another test. They had to get Sarah Hiddeny on an earlier flight because she's actually one of the New Zealand flag bearers at the opening ceremony. So she made it in time, and the rest of them have just arrived. So they've already been away a month, the New Zealand teams, and they won't be back. You know, they've got to do 2 weeks in a hotel after this as well, so they're going to be away something like 7-8 weeks, but so far so good, I think, aside from them falling over and missing flights.
Have you seen it, Byrnesy? It's a good one. It basically goose steps
I haven't seen.
He somehow accelerates on the way down. It's quite impressive. It's almost as bad a trip as yours in Japan so far, mate. It was spectacular.
Literally worst tourist in Tokyo award going right to me. The laptop debacle, the isolation. I mean, I finally got some beers. I Uber Eats some beers to me, and now we're podding, so it's all good. Look, for people who are just tuning in, only for the women's preview, we did discuss in a bit more length last night on the men's preview that one of the major themes is that it's going to be 13 per squad. So all the teams are going to be allowed to select 13 players. And then for each game, they're going to be allowed to select 12 from that 13 and put them into the game. So that's an extra dynamic that you touched upon there, Rikki. I think, am I right in saying that Will Warbrick has been selected as the 13th player for the Kiwi men? But I couldn't find out who's going to be the 13th Kiwi woman.
Sam, it's Tanika Willison for the women, pretty experienced player, been around a while. So completely different approach from the women, because for the woman, she's a more of a playmaker style as opposed to William Warbrick, who can play out wide. And the men have really looked for versatile players. I know there's been a lot made of Caleb Clark not being in the team, but they, you know, William Warbrick can kind of switch between a few positions. But yeah, for the women, they don't really have, I guess they didn't really have that kind of powerhouse option to be able to bring in. So they've gone for an extra playmaker in Tanika Willison.
You got to get into, though, just in terms of this Kiwi women, how incredible personalities are they? I know we saw a lot on social media and we see a lot the wider world, the Sevens talking about it, but you know, intimately, the incredible set of people.
Yeah, they're an awesome bunch. And you know, I guess when you have a lot of success too, it can go one of either way. And they've grown in stature, like what we would call a New Zealand mana is what they carry. But they're just genuinely good people. And like I did a story with Sarah Hiddeney, well, Gossy, when she was then before the Rio Olympics. And she was a young captain. And just to see her grow and the person and the personality. But they are genuinely good people. They are genuinely as close knit a unit as they appear on their Instagrams and when you see them in tournaments and all of that. And yes, they are hugely successful as well. So that probably always helps, doesn't it, to make a team tick along nicely and to make everything seem rosy. But they're a really cool bunch, like the sort of people that you wander down the street, you bump into them. And in New Zealand, you tend to bump into people quite regularly that you know, because everybody knows everyone. You know, like Kelly Brazier's wife is really good family, friends with my family, that sort of stuff. And they'll stop and have a yarn, always got time for you to ask about different things. They're great with kids. I think they really are very aware of their position, as they are effectively the first female professional rugby players in New Zealand, who, and you know, they are full-time professional, not like the Black Ferns 15s, and so they take that on board pretty well. But yeah, they're cool. They're just genuinely good people.
It's worth giving a bit of a rap as well to Sarah Goss, because she's going to be the flag bearer as well for New Zealand. We spoke about this last night. There's actually going to be five flag bearers, yeah. Because Rustila Nagasal of Fiji, Jerry Tuai, Nate Hiriyama, and someone give me the fifth.
Well, it's not Sarah Goss.
Someone from Kenya.
She's changed her name, to be fair, mate.
It's one of the Kenyan players, but I can't think who it is off the top of my head.
Is it?
Is it not Collins?
Unless it's Andrea Monde.
Gotta be Collins
today. I'm sure it's one of the Kenyan players.
It's Andrea Monde, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, yep. It is. He's 38 or 37. Yep.
Andrea Monde.
How old he is? Incredible. The bull.
God, yeah, I reckon you'd have to cut Collins and Jera in half and count the rings to get his age. Who knows? Who knows? That guy's been playing so long. Look, all right. So, like, New Zealand, really tight, cohesive unit. But let's talk about their rugby. No one's beaten them forever. I mean, when it comes to, like, sure things, sure odds, I mean, I've never really known a team in a rugby competition to be so heavily backed as these Black Ferns women. Can you see anyone beating them? And also, how does that weight of expectation, like not just from your own country, but from the rest of the rugby world, weigh upon them? I know that they're like a cool and relaxed and chilled out bunch who just go out there to love playing rugby, but it's a huge amount of pressure for them.
Yeah, it is. And I think obviously that Rio situation, when they won the silver medal in Rio, that is, you know, constantly replayed for them. Clark Laidlaw actually said it today in the press conference with the men. He said any team that wears a black jersey has expectation on them, and that goes for the women as well. In rugby, you know, that's just how it is. And I think they take that upon themselves. But look, I looked back and did some stats in one of my very nice notebooks. I can see Vickerman having a little smug grin at that there. And
Are you a big stats geek?
Oh no, I'm not a big stats geek, but I'm a bit of a prep geek, and I do like some nice stationery. So I've got different notebooks for different things, and so I pulled out my Sevens World Series notebook a couple of weeks ago and went back and had a look through, you know, old results, and they've won since Alan Bunting took over and him and Corey Sweeney as co-coaches post Rio. It's a 94% winning record, and that included the Commonwealth Games, the World Cup, the recent Oceanias, and that Fast Four tournament they played in Hamilton a couple of years back, and then plus all the World Series tournaments. So it's 94%. I have to find the number. I'll dig it out because I've got it on here, of what that translate to numbers wise in terms of how many matches. So I think there's not a lot that phases them now. They've been in lots of different situations, but I think if there is going to be one thing, and Vix and I have talked about this, or one team that will challenge them, it will be the USA women, because they are so big and so physical. They've got some out and out speedsters and well, some real game breakers. So I think that's the team to challenge them, because New Zealand are quite a small side by comparison. They don't have the enforcer in Niall Williams here. Of course, she got ruled out just before the start of the tournament, and that was, God, watch that on Instagram and dare you not to have a cry. So that, you know, she was kind of that, a bit of the enforcer. So someone needs to step in and be that real workhorse, take her role. But yeah, I mean, they've got so many options, and they've got, watching them in Townsville at the Oceanias a few weeks ago, Michaela Blyde has looked in sublime form, and Portia Woodman, I think, is a better athlete than when we last saw her on the World Series.
Oh, what a relief. look, Vix, that brings us pretty nicely on. We're basically talking about Paul A here, by the way, everybody, to GB, who are in New Zealand's pool alongside Russia and Kenya. And we're talking about that physicality. And that's one of the things that you identified from the St. George's tournament, that you felt that GB had a bit of biff about them that might be able to go toe-to-toe with the Kiwis.
Yeah, I did do, and that's always what you got to do. I think, you know, in terms of the size factor, though, genetically, they're miles off the USA team. I'd say the French are probably closest to the USA to compete with New Zealand on that front. But the thing is with New Zealand, and this is the thing worth getting into, it's that professionalism that they've got, and it's that fitness and skill set. And I think that's perhaps where only GB can match them, because they've been full-time for as long as they have been, first team to be made professional behind New Zealand. So I think it really is bringing those elements to their game that they're going to have to do well. I do think, though, even comparatively, the physicality is a long way off what New Zealand bring. And I'd say probably I'd question their pace a little bit. One of the standouts at St. George's was Rona Lloyd, and she hasn't made it. So I think, you know, you've got Deb Femmer, you've got Celia Kwanza as the two kind of effectively trying to be the blind.
Jazz Joyce as well.
Yeah, I think, you know, in terms of having the prop wing combination is what I was trying to say, like for the Woodman Blyde combo, because Porsche would prop that, either score with Blyde on one side, or Porsche would then drop back to the right and then she would score. So, you know, if Jazz Joyce is going to be in there, then that's the similar type of pattern that GB will play. But I do think there is a sizable gap between GB and New Zealand.
Yeah, Vix, I was surprised if they didn't pick Rona Lloyd, and I wondered with GB too. I think it's a good squad, it's a solid squad, but I just wonder where that little bit of X factor is. You kind of know what you're going to get. Maybe Jazz Joyce is it, because we don't see her as much on the World Series. That was maybe what they were just lacking a little bit. And I take my hat off to GB and what they've gone through to even get to this point. I was surprised that they didn't go with Rona Lloyd too.
Yeah, it is spot on. You actually think about how New Zealand play the game, and if it isn't the two wings that do the damage, then they've got Brazier in the middle, they've got Gail Broughton who can just step for fun, and that's where there's an extra dimension to the Black Ferns. You don't get that with GB, because as you say, you've got Meg Jones as the playmaker, but other than that, you're probably struggling. The person who does the most damage from what we've seen in the build-up is actually probably Abby Brown in the middle with the half-break offload, and she's gone because she's got a bit of pace about her. So really interesting how that's going to match up. And this is like the same with any sevens team. You can normally deal with one or two threats, but it's when you've got seven across the face of the line that's really, really quite tough.
And you didn't
Kaka, think she's looking good as well.
We haven't even mentioned Stacey Flewler as well, who was World Series Player of the Year.
Oh, man, she is just my favourite player.
The smiling assassin.
Just play all day. The smiling assassin. I mean, how good just to have her in the game. She's unreal.
Yeah, she's a great person. She played a lot of 15s last year in the Farah Palmer Cup in our domestic 15s competition, and carved up that comp. She was, you know, in fact, actually, her, Portia Woodman and Ruby Tui were the top three try scorers in that competition last year. She almost got them to win the title. They lost by one in the final. But yeah, she's become a bit of a superstar at home as well, Stacey Flewler.
You didn't even mention Ruby Tui, did we? That is ridiculous.
We can't just talk about New Zealand. No. We can't just talk about New Zealand.
They're going to be household names.
Blockbusters everywhere.
They're going to be household names in about two weeks.
So we're settled. They're winning pool A. Just one last thing on the GB team, and you touched on it there as well, Rikki, that so Jazz Joyce, and then you've got the two Scottish girls in there, Lisa Thompson and Hannah Smith. How do you think they're going to cope? Because in terms of top-level experience, it's slim compared to everybody else.
And this is a whole different level, is it? You sometimes wonder how the non-crowd factor will actually help or hinder some. And I think maybe that sort of lack of the roar of the crowd might help a few of the less experienced players or the less experienced team. But a couple of those Scottish girls played in Biarritz at the end of the 2019 season. Time doesn't, God knows when it was. The World Series final that year.
Difficult to keep track of these days.
Yeah. It might have been last week. I don't know. And they were really impressive. And they didn't look overawed by that occasion. I mean, they were outclassed a couple of times, but they scored some really good tries. And there was, I really enjoyed watching them play. So with the experience that they have around them with the rest of the English women, I wouldn't imagine it'll be too big of a deal. And I mean, Jazz Joyce has played on some pretty big stages now as well.
I think it would be a different conversation if it were a double leg event, because they just haven't experienced backing up tournaments week on week. But it's not, is it? It's two games a day for 3 days. So I think it's a very different prospect.
Look, the other big name in there is Russia, who won the Monaco repechage, or their half of it. Plenty of tries from Elena Zrakova. It's going to be their first Olympics, having missed out last time. They're prevalent on the series. And then the other team in there is Kenya, who typically are powerful. Their key player, probably Janet Akalo. But let's talk about Russia and what sort of upset they might be able to bring to both New Zealand and GB.
I mean, who knows with Russia? Every time I've watched them or commentate, they can look utterly dreadful one game and then brilliant the next. Generally, I've seen them be utterly dreadful in their first couple, and then they'll come out and they'll make a quarterfinal and push other teams. Like, I'd never back them on anything, just because I've got no idea.
That Monaco tournament did nothing, really. They were putting 50 points on everyone until they played in the final, where it was a bit tighter. But they're so, I guess, I want to say segregated, but the language barrier is massive for them on the series. So you'd never really get to know them too much. They're not, promoting their self as much as, say, Rikki Swannell would. Insular. And so you don't know too much about them. But when you look at their individual performers, and you have to get up to speed here, Byrnesy, because these marriages are throwing you off, mate. But Alina Tiron is one of the best athletes on the series. And then you got Karmadova.
No. You're mixing up your Russians. Alina Zrakova is a different player.
She's the wheels.
Thank you very much.
She's the wheels
but
out wide.
Tiron is key to it all.
Yeah, you're thinking of their captain.
Elena
you're thinking of you're thinking of McElspeth. He's now Tiron. So, back in your box, Rob Vickerman.
I said it before you had a chance to get it wrong, mate, because, Sarah Harini has been around for a few years now. And we mentioned Karmadova. So when you get Karmadova and Tiron, in a sevens team, then you do have a chance. But I do think across the board that they're probably going to struggle a bit, and they'll find that it's a significant step up from Monaco, where they were putting 70 points on teams.
Just last thing on that name thing. I find it so hard not to call Stacey Fleur Stacey Wacker, because I just think that's one of the coolest names out there. It's a real shame to say farewell to that, but you know, times do change. Right, so we're saying that New Zealand, we're saying GB are getting through from that group.
Yeah. Well, again, it's three teams, isn't it? So yeah.
Well, this is this is
three teams. You reckon? Depending on how it falls, so GB, Russia, and New Zealand. So let's look at Pool B. We've got Canada, France, Fiji, Guyana, and Brazil. So this raises up something interesting, because probably Brazil are like a markedly weaker team, and this might play significance in who's going to be one of the best third places in there.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I think with Canada, if we start with them, gosh, they've had some off-field turmoil in the last year or so, which has sort of been kept very in-house, and it's kind of one of those things everyone sort of has wondered what is going on, and it's obviously not been great, and they've kept it pretty private, and that's fair enough. So they come after all of that. I look at their squad and I think you know what you're going to get. There's some cracking players in there. They were, before the series got canned, before COVID, I think they'd made three finals. They were, you know, they were really, really consistent veteran squad. But again, yes, I do. And I'm like, I know, you know what you're going to get. You know how to scout them. You know, you've got Landry and Ben and that Charity Williams is the flyer, rock solid, but no surprises with them.
Yeah. I think they're another team we mentioned with their men actually in the previous pod that just had no build up whatsoever. Not only no build up, but the turmoil that we have seen, which we don't know a lot about, but you can't imagine it's anything other than significantly disruptive for them. So I do feel, I actually read, it was a couple of articles I read, Patrick Johnson said about them still being medal contenders. And it really shocked me. I go, oh God, yeah, medal contenders. You know, they have got a chance, but they haven't even entered my thought in terms of those final matches, really. And that's because they haven't been that prominent in the last couple of years.
Yeah, I'd definitely still have them as medal contenders, but based on what we saw pre-COVID. So I guess it's just a matter of how much this last year and a half has impacted them.
I have the French as medal contenders. I don't have Canada as medal contenders.
Yeah, I'd have the French over the Canadians. I know that, like as you said, the repechage really didn't show us an awful lot because of the weakness of the other teams that were competing in there. But I mean, France performed well on that last World Series, and they've got some blockbuster players in there as well. You can break games, and they beat New Zealand as well, didn't they? I know it seemed weird to like hop back to that World Series because it seemed so long ago, but that's got to be significant, like in their own mantra, that they're like, do you know what? We're one of the only teams to have beaten the Kiwis in the last like 3 years.
Yeah, I like France. I like France in the last couple of years. I think they've got a couple of real workhorses, Golday, and then you've got, you know, some speedsters, you know, like a Silfani player like that. I remember, I think watching her first tournament. So, but it's funny because they hadn't had a great series pre, you know, back in the day, back when we did all this. I had gone the other way, so I had based Canada as being a medal contender on that, and almost forgotten a little about France. And probably that's because of, you know, being in the opposite time zone, so not sort of seeing as much or hearing as much, and also not being able to read French is a bit difficult when you're trying to, you know, read about what they're doing as well. But absolutely, they'll be right in the mixer, and would definitely have them in contention too.
I want to talk about Fijiana. Because, and you're going to be the expert here, Rikki, because you called, did you call a few of their games to the Oceania Sevens that just went down?
No, I wasn't there.
Were you on the mic?
No,
for that?
I wasn't there. They don't let me go to Townsville. I had to stay at home. I tried. They wouldn't let me go, which probably not a bad thing because I probably would have got stuck there and never made it here. So
true. Well, more's the pity though. In terms of our Fijiana, a potential surprise package, having beaten Australia 19 points to 12 in that Oceania Sevens. Look at their team. I mean, they came eighth in the last Olympics, but I mean, they were like a bit of a, they're almost like a new side. They were a bit of an afterthought back then. They've got a completely new program. They've got completely new players. And beating Australia in Townsville, that is significant.
Yeah, it's hard to know if that's more of a reflection of where Australia is at or where Fiji is at a little bit.
She's getting it early. So Rikki started the demise of Australia now.
I haven't put the demise of Australia. I just think they're battling at the moment. We'll get to Australia.
Show us your kidneys.
No, because we'll get to them. But no, it's hard to know. And the flip side being, you know, Fiji is one that have been completely shut down. And I think that particularly for the men, but also for the women, the state of things in Fiji, I think it's going to be a really emotional tournament for them, just because things are really, really bad there at the moment. And they have been completely grounded. I mean, at least, you know, New Zealand and Australia were able to arrange their Trans-Tasman competitions. You know, New Zealand's got a squad of 20 professional players, so they were able to have internal hitouts like the Australians. And, you know, the European teams have been able to play each other. So Fiji have, pardon the pun, been an island kind of out there to themselves. and so there is that element of unknown, and a bit like Russia too, that you don't know what you're going to get with them sometimes. And they can look great one day, terrible the next. Discipline can be a factor, but they can offload, they've got pace, they're strong, you know, they've got all of that ability. It's whether they put it together in a tough pool against Canada and France. And notwithstanding that, Brazil have got a couple of players that can strike against them as well.
Yeah, looking at the shakedown of like how the pools all end up, like if you're going to say that New Zealand come first in A, and we'll just say that France come first in B, then Fiji, say they were to come third, and then Russia coming third in pool A, New Zealand are going to play either Fiji or Russia, or France going to play Fiji or Russia in the next round, which would make things interesting. So what do you think about Brazil? Can they do anything out there, guys?
No, and my only fear about Fiji is they're the loosest team on the series. Fijiana could quite feasibly finish a tournament with four players. That's how loose they are. When you see them playing, they're offloading, they're great. But then suddenly, when they're in defence, they do some crazy things. And I said before about the men, with discipline now such a factor, it just takes one ill-timed tackle and your tournament's gone. And that's a real fear for Fijiana.
Is this the legacy of former England captain Chris Cracknell, his DNA on Fijiana and leaving a red card philosophy behind?
he'd have got a few bans, I reckon, Crackers, the old shoulders back in the day. But actually, speaking of him, he was the perfect player to play against Fiji because he was so in your face. And when you're rile Fijians, they stop thinking about their fancy offloads and just think about trying to jump on your head. So just as well with the men, I think you can really frustrate the women. And there's times we've seen them on the series where they do lose that mentality and just implode.
So what are we saying, pool B, guys? We got Canada and France as the 1-2, maybe France edging it over. I think France. You think France, Vix? You think Canada, Rikki?
I'll go Canada just to be a contrarian.
And then Fijiana coming in third in the mix to get through to the quarters, which brings us neatly on to the moment that Rikki has been salivating over ever since we logged on tonight. Pool C containing USA, China, Japan, and the floor is yours, Rikki, Australia.
This is some sort of stitch up, because it's going to make me sound like the typical Kiwi against the Aussies. But it is
I've revved that up all in the name of having a bit of crack from a man who hasn't spoken to another real life human being for 5 days in a hotel room. So no, it's all coming from a learned place. But Pool C, as I said, Australia, USA, China, Japan. Let's talk about Pool C.
Well, I think I said it right at the start. I really like USA. I think they're big, strong, physical, fast. They've got some game breakers. They've got someone like Lev Kelter who can cut a team up through the middle. They've got wide players like Ma and Kershey. I think they've got a lot about them. They know that they can beat New Zealand. They've done it before. It's whether Kelter is one who can every so often have a little bit of a brain explosion. So she needs to stay on the field for a start. I think they're almost the full package. I really like the USA. It's whether, as I say, they've beaten New Zealand. It's whether they have the belief in it when it gets really tight, when the pressure comes on in a medal match. Can they stay composed throughout? I think they're a really strong squad.
What about you, Vix?
No, I agree with that. I think just looking at the draw again, it comes down to where they place. So if they do go well in Pool C, if they do top it, then clearly they'll avoid New Zealand, which everybody wants to do. Interestingly, if they do come second, it's a little bit more of a difficult route for them. But love everything about the USA. I think what they've done is really scan the market for athletes and then turn them into rugby players, which I know Mike Friday is constantly talking about, but his lieutenant, Chris Brown, is very much of the same ilk. So get them in initially just to be units and big and strong and fast, and then upskill the rugby. And I think that transitions very well, certainly the women's sevens game, because how do you stop someone that's just bigger, faster and stronger than you? It's a really difficult concept when you have got that power to overcome it. And I think they're going to really surprise a few people.
What about their form though? Right. So I hear you on the athleticism. I see them on the kickoffs. They are unbelievable kickoff reception team. But in terms of form, they went out to Madrid and they did not perform very well. And then they went out to Dubai and they didn't win out there. They had to come home early. Their recent hit out was a lot more promising in Los Angeles. But yeah, the athleticism, yeah, like they've got all the ingredients, but is it creating a marvelous medicine?
Yeah, I think, and going back to what I was saying about Kelter being that X factor player, I think they are really reliant on her to create. If they don't, if their big strong ball runners are contained, they're reliant on Kelter to create. It's not like say in New Zealand that, you know, as Vic said, there's a Brazier option, there's a Nathan. And there's a Broughton to come off the bench. So they've got those. They don't perhaps have that many options in that area. I mean, I just don't know how much in terms of form recently you can read into, given the circumstances and the way things have changed for every team. They look like they've had, just judging by their Insta, a good camp before coming in here to Tokyo, and seem in good spirits. They've got a pretty look like a well-connected team, and they're listening to Chris Brown, who's from New Zealand, listening to his message. So in a one-off game, if they can string it together, and that's what, you know, a gold medal match eventually is, a one-off, and they certainly can do it.
Yeah, it's probably like, so arguably like Pool C is like one of the most important groups out there, because whoever finishes first, as you said, Vix, avoids New Zealand, and they've got the potential to set up one roll of the dice final against the out-and-out favourites. So we got China and Japan in there, and with the greatest respect, I'm not sure that anyone would anticipate them to trouble the medals. And also due to that, you'd probably argue on points difference that that would free up a third place progression for Pool A and Pool B, which brings us on to the reigning gold medalists, Australia. So Vix, we're going to start with you, mate.
Yeah, Rikki only promised to come on this if she could have a good run up to Australia. So I'll let her go second. But no, I've been speaking to a fair few people about this, because it is going to be quite an interesting story to go from gold medalists to potentially not being, and why that is. And I think if you look at how that team have evolved, I think one of the biggest things about that Australian team was losing Tim Walsh. I think as soon as he did leave and step aside to the men's program, you could see their identity completely changed. They had to change a few things. They brought in some brilliant youngsters, but I think they're quite a way off from what we saw in Rio. And I think it's always going to be difficult to that. And often it's said in sport, isn't it, that it's the easiest thing is to win. And then the hardest thing is then back it up, because you've got teams constantly raising their game against you. So I think they've really suffered from that. And some big personalities within the team have probably been splintered a little bit. And I think taking away Ilya Green has got that thing that we mention X factor all the time in sport, but rugby specifically, she can transform games, and her not being there, appreciate the youngsters coming through are highly regarded, but that shows to me how far off they have gone, because you wouldn't ever let something as good as that and as raw talent as she is drop off. And I think that's probably quite a familiar thing across with three or four of those players.
Yeah. They're a real conundrum as to where things are going, but like, a couple of times watching on the Oceanias that, like, Elia, gosh, she's such a wonderful player. She got just done all ends up in defence a couple of times. I think they really, really miss Alicia Lucas, because she was just such a workhorse for them and allowed Keslick to do what she can do. Now, Keslick, watching her both in the Trans-Tasman when they came over to New Zealand, they came over to the, for the series in Auckland, it was almost like she was having to do too much. She's always that, like, the hustle on defence. She's trying to keep the tempo going, taking all that on. So I think they really miss her. Obviously, Chloe Dalton, that just sucks, her getting ruled out the way she did, having come back. And, she had surgery. She'd got herself fit. It is such a shame for them. And I think that's obviously had to change their plans a little bit. A couple of those youngsters are really exciting. I know Shawnee Maloney said that Madison Levi, he was really impressed with her. But huge ask for them for her to come in and really step up. Interesting, I had someone say to me today or something that if this 13th player rule, had the Aussies perhaps known about it sooner, they may have picked Elia Green, knowing that they could have said, you know what, go and play, you only have to play three games. Or you only have to have, this much effort, and they could have carried her a little bit more. So, but because that rule seemed to be changed quite late, that they weren't able to do that, or they just decided not to do that.
Yeah, it was such an extraordinary omission to see Elia Green not make it. I mean, it was one of those where you're reading the social media posts and you're like, have I read this right? Like, am I hallucinating? Like, so crazy to see her miss out. I'm really glad you brought up the 13th player rule, because the teams that have selected wider squads have definitely benefited from this late change. Like, how big of an imbalance do you reckon that could prove to be? And I've spoken to someone connected to Australia as well, and I think that, not specifically to Elia Green, but it did get mentioned that it might have changed the makeup or the approach, definitely.
Name your sources.
Cannot name my sources, cannot reveal. Yeah,
it's become a tactical play, hasn't it? And like in any game, you want to try and get an advantage. And if you can bring in that absolute bull of a player and say, right, you can do 2 minutes every other game, why would you not look at doing that? So I think, yeah, teams have had to adjust to that. But there's many things, as you know more than most, Byrnesy, that are pretty unique in this situation.
My only source could possibly be the hotel concierge here who brings up my lunch every day. That's the only person I'm speaking to.
It's interesting. Clark Laidlaw again, he said today it might just allow them to sort of manage a couple of guys early on or girls early on, protect a couple of players if there's a few niggles or given the conditions. And the conditions is something interesting too. I don't know if you guys talked about it with your men's preview, but what the weather may do and how big of a factor that could be. I mean, I know for a start it's going to be disastrous for my lid because humidity and rain is not ideal. But that skill defensively, if it is torrential rain, that could be a big factor as well.
That is so un-British of us. Shame on us, Vic. We haven't touched on the weather at all.
I mentioned it, didn't I?
Mate, that's an icebreaker for us usually from the Northern Hemisphere.
Well, just to talk, I'm sure I did last night. Anyway, we're saying that it's been 32 degrees pretty much all week. Oh, that was it. Okay. It's expected thunderstorms, slight typhoon, and then very much rain for the first 4 days of next week. So, yeah, absolutely. The humidity is one thing, but when it's a wet ball, as we saw in the 2019 Men's World Cup, when that ball gets slippy, it's just carnage. But typically, Ricky's first thought was her appearance. It's just relentless.
Well, usually I'm used to not being on camera, and I have to be on camera over here, and it's not, my favourite thing. So, and these aren't my optimal conditions. It's very hot. I bought my portable fan, USB chargeable portable fan, arrived on Amazon today. So, that might be a saving grace.
As you can see from where Vix is conducting his podcast from, he's got an OnlyFans obligation coming up from his bed that he's going to be live streaming obviously later on. So
Byrnesy, I know you've been on your own a lot in your room, but we do not need to be hearing about your OnlyFans subscriptions, mate. Just leave
that there. Have you got a book up there as well, Vix, to make us think you're a bit smarter than you are?
Hey, there we go. Yeah, fake law. Well spoiled.
The secret barrister.
Well, I know you're very well read, Rikki, not Byrnesy, so I thought I better at least blag it.
Good.
Right, But you, in all seriousness, you've got to go the second, Vic. So we better wrap this up because we've all got an opening ceremony to get drunk watching. So Paul C, I mean, we're saying Australia and USA are getting out. You guys are going USA, coming out one. I'm going to go Australia. I'm going to mix it up. Coming out one and could create a showdown final.
Yeah, it's good that someone's opting to be wrong, Byrnes. It's a good job it's you.
Well, it's all going to come out in the wash, isn't it, from Thursday onwards next week? So
yeah, we'll see, mate. We'll see. I tell you what, it will change the game of sevens if USA sevens do very well at this tournament for men or women.
Yeah, man, that would be awesome, wouldn't it? It would be good. Right, so it's time for winners. We went with Caramel Stallions last night for the men's because there aren't any dark horses in there. So I've been thinking long and hard. We're going for Grey Mares. Grey Mares for the women. No dark horses because everyone's got a good shot.
We're going to do that.
Is that allowed? I don't know if I'm straight.
Benzie, this is
am I saying something bad? Like, I genuinely Googled what is a female horse called. I'm not looking to Philly. Yes, exactly. Yes. Sorry, Grey Fillies. Grey.
Going for
Philly.
Probably
safer than
Fillies. We're going. Oh, I didn't want to get myself into hot water.
All right, lucky you can stay in your room for another week and nobody will see you. Nobody will know who you are. Okay.
Media blackout. Grey fillies. We got grey fillies. Dark horses. USA, yeah?
USA.
So who's your winners? Are we all going New Zealand? We're all going New Zealand, aren't we?
I'd have to revoke my passport if I didn't anyway, so...
And then who's your outside filly then?
France, bronze.
I was just going to say France. I was going to say France as well.
You can agree with me. Don't worry about it. I will remind you consistently.
It'll be your first time for everything. Then I'm going to agree with Vex. France is the grey filly.
I've got to go for someone different now. Huh? I'm going to go GB. Why not? Bit of patriotism.
Fair enough.
At the death in the seventh heaven. Right, Vix, you got to go, haven't you?
Yeah, well, it's been a pleasure. Always good to chat to Rikki, less so to you, Byrnesy, but thanks for your time, mate.
Rikki, can I just say what an absolute pleasure it's been to have you up in seventh heaven, and would love to welcome you back anytime. And what I've had a blast, and I'm sure our listeners are going to as well when they're listening back to this.
I hope so. It has been my honour. It's my first time we've just met, and I think we've got along famously and now uniting against Rob Vickerman, who I hadn't seen for a year and a half, and I'd forgotten that he is Dennis the Menace. But I must admit, even with the World Series break, I might have missed him just a little bit, and the last 2 days have probably said that it was just a little bit.
There we go. That's the highest order. Thank you very much.
Looking forward to ganging up on him with you, Rikki. Right, that is it for another episode of your Celestial One-Stop Pod for all things rugby sevens. The men kick off on Monday, the women on Thursday. Do not miss a minute. They're going to be two tournaments you're going to wish that you'd watched and you're going to tell your kids about it. But until next time, from all of us up here in Seventh Heaven, it is adios.